Thank you. Hello everyone. Welcome to the video.
All right. Yeah. I didn't change anything.
Welcome to the Santa Barbara Polo and Racquet Club for the final of the Pacific Coast Open. 2023 NetJets Pacific Coast Open, and we have Brookshire taking on Farmers and Merchants Bank. Brookshire enters this game, one of the hottest teams on the West Coast. They've won seven of their last eight games, and they've been led by the play of Tomas Pinello. He leads all players in this tournament with 29 goals. Now, they had to overcome a comeback from Antelope in their semifinal game to capture the 10-8 victory. And Brookshire had a five-goal lead at halftime and had Antelope come back, pulling within one. But in the fifth tucker, Peke Gonzalez and Paquito Dennerweis scored from the field to withstand the Antelope comeback and claim the two-goal win. Brookshire won both the Silver Cup and the America Cup this year and have been identified as the team to beat going for the sweep, trying to win the big one, the PCO, here today.
F&B comes into today's final with a lineup that they have only used over the past two games, but it will be impressive. There was an impressive victory in the semifinals over the Clinton Ranch. Since Lucas Criado Jr. joined the lineup, F&B ranks first in goals scored with 12.3 per game, as he only trails Tomas Pinello in scoring, along with Pelon Sterling. It creates a formidable duo for F&B. But the play of Will Bush and Alonzo Andrade cannot be forgotten, as they both played exceptionally well in that semifinal. F&B hasn't shot at goal as often as other teams, but they have the only team shooting that's shooting above 50% in the tournament, setting the scene for today and what should be an exciting final here today. I'm Toby Wayman, joined with me as always Cody Offen, and we are so excited to get this final underway.
Thank you, Toby, and some pregame ceremonies here for the final. Let's take a look at how both of these teams got here today. Brookshire again defeated Antelope 10-8 in the semifinals, while Farmers and Merchants Bank defeated Clintner Ranch 14-10 in their game. A little closer than that scoreline might look there, as they got a couple at the end to cement that victory. Clintner Ranch really put up a great fight in that semifinal matchup. Setting up this game, Toby, and really it's going to be tough to pick a winner again. Of course, Brookshire may be the slight favorite just because of their record here this season. But hey, you can never count out F&B, especially with the former 10-goaler, Pelon Sterling, on the field.
Yeah, and an interesting storyline that we have today is the head-to-head matchup between Lucas Criado Jr. and Peke Gonzalez. After playing together all season with Iconica and Valiente in Florida, we sat down with both of them ahead of today's final.
The ball to me a lot. Nah, I think it's been an amazing season. We've been friends for a long time, but I think this season was amazing. To be able to play with both leagues and both teams, it's been incredible. So I think we learned a lot and we shared a lot of good moments. So it's been amazing.
Mostly the season, the entire season, like he said, the moments after the games and before the games that we enjoyed. I don't think we will ever have a season like that, but I mean, we just have to enjoy it and remember it as a good one, one of the best ones. Peke, he likes to go forward, so he gives his other teammates a chance to work a little bit the ball and then put it in front for him. And he makes you play really comfortable in the back, because always you have a little bit of time that gives you a lot of help.
No, Negrito is really super talented. He can shoot from everywhere and scores, really tricky with the ball. He moves around the field, so he's not easy to follow around. You have to have an eye on him because he's really tricky. He fakes going one way and then he goes the other way and then he comes around. So you have to crush him. That's the only way. When we play against each other or not, we're always together. We go and have lunch maybe tomorrow, no, the acai together,
not
or
tomorrow.
No? Well, we've been going to have lunch the acai together, so maybe it depends on him. I don't matter. Going tomorrow with him, but...
No, tomorrow after the game only. pero sí.
I didn't know that part. I didn't know that part about him, but no, I don't mind. I don't mind at all.
All right, love to see those two guys, two best friends there, getting to play together. They had such an incredible season this past year, like they were talking about. You know, they played with Valiente, and they played with Iconica. The two of them in the 16-goal and then the 22-goal level, along with Adolfo Cambiaso and Santos Merlos, respectively, in the 22-goal and the 16-goal, and Maureen Brennan there with in the 16-goal. And Bob Drenovich for Valiente in the 22 goals. So, I mean, very special season for those guys, and it's so much fun to watch them play together. But today, it should be a great game to watch these two players play against each other, along with Tomas Pinelo, probably the hottest mallet out there on the West Coast, one of the hottest mallets in the world right now on his way up. So, you know, I don't know. It's going to be a tough one here, Cody. I couldn't tell you who I think is going to win this game at this point.
It's extremely exciting, and with those two young superstars, Luquitas and Peque, as we've seen all year, each of those two players individually have the ability to take over and win a game, and both of them have a higher-rated player behind them with mm-hmm. them on their teams, which just makes this matchup so fun on paper, and it's going to be even more fun once the ball gets rolling here, Toby. Again, so tough to pick a winner. Brookshire may be the favorite, but look at what FMB did to Kluntner Ranch in the semifinals. I think nobody really saw that game falling the way it did, 14-10. But here we go, Toby.
Especially, you're right, after, you know, the Kluntner Ranch team came out swinging so hard in the first half. I think they were winning by 5 goals by halftime. And then, you know, Farmers and Merchants was able to slowly build back and stick around. And then all of a sudden, you know, next thing you know, they're up by a goal or two. And then they end up, like you said, winning 14-10. So, fantastic performance there. I will say this. Be watching today for Pelon Sterling to be moving up in the field today. He's going to put some more pressure. He's going to put pressure on Tomas Pinelo, and he's really going to pressure the front part of the game and try to get their game lined out. He's going to try to put the pressure on Pinelo, and they're going to. And I would imagine they're going to start again with Lucas Criado Jr. knocking the ball in on the set plays, but we can talk more about that here in a minute because we're about to have the national anthem. So we're going to go fieldside right now there to the Santa Barbara Polo and Racquet Club for the singing of the national anthem. And then Cody and I will join you right after that. Yep. All right, beautiful rendition there of the national anthem. Now they're going to go ahead and introduce these two teams field side, and as they do, we'll go ahead and introduce these two teams to you, our viewers at home here on the USPA Polo Network. Let's see which way they're going to start. Our umpires today are on the field there. That's Kimo and Martin Pasquale. Kimo Huddleston, Martin Pasquale. These are the two umpires that actually umpired the finals of the U.S. Open this year in Florida, and now they're here doing the finals of the Pacific Coast Open. So that's pretty awesome in and of itself. And here we go. So we'll start off with Brookshire playing number one, Scott Wood, In the number two position, you've got Peke Gonzalez. Number three is going to be Paquito Di Narváez. And then playing number four is Tomas Pinello. 29 goals scored by Pinello so far. Wow, that is impressive right there. All right. And then for the FMB team, playing number one, we've got Will Bush. And Will is playing Danny Walker's horses. Then Lucas Criado Jr. is coming into the number two slot. Pelon Sterling playing the number three position today. And Alonso Andrade coming in that number four position today. And I have to say, exceptional play from Alonso in their semifinal game against Clinton Ranch. For me, that guy played just lights out. At a two-goal handicap, he was really, really getting a lot of things done. And so it's going to be fun to see what he does here today, because in order for FMB to win this game, all four players are going to have to bring their A games today. What did you say, Cody?
Absolutely, and we talked about that in the Clintner Ranch game as well, how their handicap is a little more centrally based, while Brookshire a little more balanced between the three pros. So those two-goal players for FMB have to make a big impact. And I think the biggest thing, you know, as well as Alonso played, he made a lot of great plays. He really limited making mistakes. He didn't get himself into trouble, create fouls, and he kept himself in good positions, I think, which allowed him to play so well, Toby. And I agree with you that he certainly played the most above his handicap in that semifinal game.
Absolutely. Okay, here we go.
So just a ceremonial bull in there, and it looks like everybody's going to peel off to change on to their first chucker horses.
Yeah, that's right. Because, yeah, you know, as you might know, if you're tuning in here, it is one of those cases where, you know, guys usually, when there's, you know, being the feature game of the week and the finals of the tournament, you want to start on one of your spares, because, you know, these horses are the most finely tuned equine athletes on the face of the planet. They do everything that a cutting horse, a racehorse, and a reining horse does all at the same time for 7.5 minutes. So they are just as invested in the game as we are. So, you know, if you go out there on your first chucker horse and go through the ceremonial parade, the national anthem, the introduction, all that, by the time you get to the first throwing, your horse, a lot of them will wash themselves out. That it'll be like they've already played a chucker. They'll be so amped up. So that's why these guys usually start on a spare, something nice and quiet, something that's not going to be bothered by the flags. Then they go back and they jump on their first chucker horses here. And speaking of, I know that we do have Lucas Criado Jr. playing Lock Syrup here, which he says is his favorite, along with his father's favorite. And we're going to get to see him, hear him speak about this horse a little bit during an interview that we have coming up in between the first and second chuckers. So do keep an eye out on Lucas Criado Jr. and Lock Syrup. Syrup, yeah, as they say.
He'll be coming out on Syrup in the second chucker. I think we'll hear him.
Oh, I'm sorry. You're right. Yep.
Yeah, but I think we'll hear him talk about Syrup before that. He's got another homebred Lac Petita here in the first chucker.
And one of the siblings, I believe.
Exactly. And we can see Peke Gonzalez on your screen there coming out on his favorite horse, Cinco. And Tomas Pinello, bottom of your screen, he's starting on Dolphina Coronada. We've seen him play this horse usually in the first or second chucker and then again later in the game. As always, I mean, all of these guys are so well mounted, not a bad horse on the field, but we'll try to pick out the ones to keep an eye on, our favorites. And you know what, mm-hmm. If you have any favorites at home, feel free to chime in, let us know who you're looking at.
Absolutely, yeah, hit us up in the comment section on Facebook. You know, it's probably the easiest way to get a hold of us.
Yeah, and I was just going to say, sorry, Toby, to interrupt you there, Will Bush, nope. I just saw in the background, you mentioned he's riding Danny Walker's horses. That is a Criado horse as well, Lac Chano, that he's starting on, that beautiful gray horse for Will Bush.
Yeah, and you know, this is the first time that that Will Bush has played at this level of polo, coming in and taking the place of injured Danny Walker. So we wish Danny a speedy recovery, but Will's been doing a good job holding down the fort for him ever since. And like I said before, you know, this is going to be fun. Be watching for Pelon to really, you know, push that, you know, try to get Brookshire's back against the wall. He's going to try to apply pressure to Tomas. And then, you know, how Tomas is, I mean, this guy is so good. I remember talking to Joaquin Pinello, Tomas's brother, years and years ago. And he was, you know, saying, just, you know, wait till you see my brother. He's the real deal. He's the total package. And I remember thinking, okay, cool, you know, whatever. And then all of a sudden this kid explodes onto the scene this year. And I'm like, wow, yeah, you know what? He was not wrong about that at all. His brother is the real deal. And it's great to see him out here playing in California here at the Santa Barbara Polo and Racquet Club.
100%. Just an incredible player. I mean, not huge by stature, but when he's on the polo field, he is just an animal, and he just seems to win every battle he goes into.
Ooh, Tony. Look at that. And Tomas is able to feed this ball back up, and here comes Sterling. Near side back shot. First one to get turned is going to be Paquito. Paquito picks up the ball, fakes the back shot. Sterling doesn't take the bait. Now he goes to run past the man, and it looks like he's going to get away from him. First guy to get there is Alonzo Cruz, is going to come in here to put some pressure on. Excuse me. That's going to be Will Bush there. And now it's going to be a back shot here from Will. And then Paquito gives it over here to Tomas. Now Paquito gets there, and he's going to pick up the first point of the day right here by running it through the post. Well done, Paquito. Sends that ball straight on through and picks up the first point of the day. 1-0. Now the score.
Fantastic goal early on here for Brookshire. Paquito de Nervais, the youngster. Man, we talked so much about Pinelo and Peque Gonzalez. We almost overlook this kid sometimes.
Yeah, and he's a great player.
Yeah, we could talk about him all day. Another player who, I mean, I would put some money on him getting to 10 goals one day, Toby.
Watch, Alonzo Cruz is going to win this throw-in right here. Alonzo now takes it forward. Alonzo runs it. Oh, loses the play there for a second. Paquito jumps back on it. Now Cruz riding hard to get there. He's going to leave that ball behind. It's going to be picked up right here. And well done. Lucas Criado Jr. leaves the ball now for Sterling. Sterling fires that ball back down the field here looking for Bush. Will comes in. He's going to be challenged by Scott Wood. Now picked up here by Will. Going to that goal from left to right. Can't get back. Yes, he does. He gets back to it. It's going to be a clean play. Now here comes the play by Sterling. He turns it back to the inside. Sterling gets back towards that goal. He's right there. He's in the red zone. He takes a shot. It's knocked down by Pinelo. And now it is over the back line wide. So we'll have our first knock in of the day go in favor of Brookshire here.
Good little battle there between Peque and Luquitas. Remember from that interview, Peque said he's so crafty, so sneaky. You really just have to go in and crush him. He tried to there, but Luquitas was able to check up and use one of those crafty little plays to stay away from him.
And this is the other thing that you're going to see here, like I was saying before. You know, you got Sterling going to the hitter on these knock on these set plays. Now here comes the shot back down. Peque reaches out. He does not connect on the ball and is picked up here by Lucas. He leaves it behind. Here comes Pinelo to take it back to the left. And now Lucas moves back over to try to get a hold of Pinelo. Pinelo dropping the horse's head. He's looking good. He's out in front. He's at the 30-yard line right here. Cannot connect. And it's taken now by Criado. Look at that. Calm as can be. Just a straight ice in his veins as he takes that ball out of the goal mouth. Then hits a pass back over here where he's going to find Sterling on the fly, who pounds that ball forward. Coming in, Scott Wood is there for the defense. Wood with a tail shot. Picked off again right here by Sterling as Pinelo tries to get back around to him to make a defensive play. Now Sterling with control of the ball, looking good, going to the goal. Now Sterling runs into some traffic right there, loses the play, and is going to be picked up here by Criado Jr. Lucas taps it forward, forcing the man out of his way. He's going to shoot at the goal right here. And here comes Peque, leaves the ball behind for Pinelo. Tomas decides to keep it going here. Whoop, little miscommunication maybe there by between the two men. And now Peque lays a pick on Luquitas. Pinelo breaks back to the right-hand side right here. Now, and Sterling's going to come in to put some pressure on Pinelo. Pinelo sees he's got some running room. He's got his man beat right now. Sterling goes up as Tomas holds the ball. He's looking for somebody to go up to be a target for him. Now he gets crushed right here by Sterling. Back shot by Alonzo. Almost hit the drone, too. That was awesome. Open back shot right here. Picked up now by Criado and Tomas. Pinelo back on it. Pinelo takes it back to the left. Creates some more space for himself to work. Keeps that ball going. Drops it. Now it's picked up again here by Sterling. Back to the inside. Sterling. Look at Paquito. Looking at his man and looking at the man with the ball. He winds up, he sends this one forward. Here comes Will Bush and Scott Wood, along with Peque. All three going to the goal, going to the ball. Now, well done. Nicely done here by Will. Picked up by Cruz, by Alonzo. Andrade, he gets taken out by Scott Wood. Great play by Wood right there to not let Alonzo do what he wants to do with that ball. And it's going to be Tomas Pinelo to pick up the play. Pinelo drops it back right here. Coming back in, it's going to be Peque to Gonzalez to take that ball forward as Will wants a whistle, doesn't find it, though, and Alonzo goes straight zone back. And here is where this gelding accelerates, or should I say excels. He accelerates very nicely to the goal by himself out in front. Peque looking over his shoulder, only has to outrun Alonzo by 52 inches. He's there. He's in the red zone. One more. He leaves it behind. Next player to get there is going to be Luquitas Criado. turns that ball back around. Lucas has got Sterling behind him as Peke comes in to put some pressure on him. Now he'll go ahead and leave that ball and take the man with him, and Sterling goes back to the left. Sterling looking good right here as Peke comes in to put some pressure on the man. Now Sterling being patient right here. This is one of the things that Lucas Criado said, that he's really, you know, learned a lot from Sterling is learning patience. And one of the games, part of the game that he thinks he's improved most on is his patience. And I'd have to agree with him. Now jumping out of there's going to be Tomas Pinelo. Gets to it with an open back shot. And here it goes. Look at this horse right here by Luquitas. Excuse me, by... Oh, nice try at the goal. But it's going to be over the back line here. Yeah, so a nice try there from Paquito de Narvaez. He's so well mounted. You know, his dad's got a... His family has a big breeding operation there in Argentina. And provides some really nice horses here for his son to play.
Sorry to interrupt there. Yeah, I like the fact we don't see a whistle wholesale change there, Toby. I don't think anybody had been able to change horses yet.
Yeah, it's just been up and
over
down.
5 minutes.
All right. Alonso drops the ball. That could be a costly mistake. Here's Tomas with an open back shot, but it's going to be picked up right now by Sterling. He gets the ball picked up, turned back around to the inside. He winds up. He fires back down the field, looking for some help here from Bush. Scott gets to it, hits his back shot. Nicely done right there. Oh, Paquito, good play. Keeps the man away. Stolen here by Cruz. Alonso gives it back over to Criado. Now it's going to be... There's a whistle. So they're going to blow this one against Paquito for riding the player into the right-of-way or holding him in the right-of-way, pushing the player into the right-of-way. Just a question of ball placement now. They're going to go down to a goal shot penalty. Will it be an open goal or penalty four? Let's see.
Yeah, finally the first whistle here in the first chucker in the ball game. Take another look. A bit of a traffic jam and Paquito pushing one green player into the other there. That's why the whistle sounds. And the first attempt here for either side. You can see a bit of a windy day out there. You'll see in a moment when you take a look at the flags on the goalpost. So that could come into factor here on these penalty shots. But dangerous players on both teams. As Luquitas gets this teed up, he'll likely take this penalty shot here for FMB.
Penalty number four coming up, going in favor of FMB, giving them a chance to get on the board for the first time today. Criado. Well, the wind is blowing now. Luquitas hits it along the ground. Can he thread the needle right here? It's up in the air. Sterling on the ball. Oh. Now we have a whistle stopping the clock at 41 seconds. And they're going to move this one down to center field here, it looks like, to go in favor of Brookshire.
It's actually
one meeting two.
Luquitas' first miss from the 60 here in the PCO tournament. He was 2 for 2 on penalty fours and 1 for 1 on penalty six safety attempts coming into this game. Not sure if he meant to hit it along the ground. Again, very windy. You could hear it and see it on the flags there. A bit of a miss hit into traffic.
Good call by the umpires right there. One meeting two.
I must say, Toby, going back just before that foul by Paquito, we saw a good back shot by Scott Wood. And I was thinking about it in the semifinal game. This whole tournament, he's been extremely, extremely solid hitting his back shots. I'm not sure he's really missed any. And he always puts a little angle on them, even if they don't go far. And it seems to always find one of his teammates. So a big credit to Scott Wood in that number one jersey.
Yeah, and they trust him to hit those shots, too. We're down to around 30 seconds left to go here in chucker number one. FMB still trying to find their way onto the board. Here comes. Oh, look at that. What a play from Sterling over here to Criado at midfield. Lucas winds up, sends it forward again. Coming in, it's going to be Will Bush to reach out there. Doesn't connect. And Tomas Pinelo comes out with the ball. He's running short on time. Last couple seconds here. Can he get back around? Now he takes that one back. And Pinelo still working it down as Bush comes in to try to put some pressure on him. Tomas looking for extra yardage right here. His shot back towards the goal. And it's going to be over the back line. And I believe that's a buzzer beater right there. So tough break there for Paquito, missing that little flip. Next shot at the goal. So if I'm not mistaken, we're going to be starting this next chucker off with a knock-in to be taken by FMB after this quick break right here on the USPA Polo Network.
Playing with Pelon, you learn a lot, mostly because in England and here, of course, I had the chance to be in the barn with him. So you learn about all the horses and everything from the grooms, from him, his pilot. So you get to know everything that you do before a game. And I think it really makes you improve a lot. I think I learned a lot in Florida with playing with Cambiaso and then with Pelon and Kubi. That are guys that have been playing, have a lot of experience. To be patient, to remain calm as well on the difficult moments of the game. Usually you win or you lose. And I think I've been getting a little bit better each game, so I'm trying to concentrate a lot in that. Of course, Brookshire is the team to beat this season. They've been playing amazing with Paquito, Peque, Scott playing amazing as well, Tomas, we know what he can do. I think we have to be concentrated in putting pressure in every play and not risking the ball, because if you give them the ball, it's almost guaranteed a goal. So we have to take care a lot of the ball and not risk it a lot. No, I think really good. My dad played them the first two tournaments, so he's been taking good care of them. Of course, they're his. Lax Syrup is my favorite because she's really small, but I think she has the power to beat any type of horse, and she has a really nice mouth. I mean, in these fields that are a little bit smaller, I think, you kind of have everything here. So here, I think she makes a really big difference and gives you a lot of confidence.
All right, welcome back to the USPA Polo Network. Getting ready to start the second chucker here, and that is Lax Syrup that Lukitas is coming out on now. And let's check out that head-to-head graphic between him and his dad, if we can, before we get going here. Lucas Criado Jr. and Sr. So 24 goals between the two of them.
34 goals now. Lukitas is up to 24 himself, Toby, in the tournament.
Wow. Very nice. All right, so look at it. Oh, go ahead.
No, I was just going to say the second leading scorer, only Pinello has more than Lukitas coming into this final.
Well, let's see. Right of way against Criado Jr. here is what they're saying. Penalty five from the spot. Well, they went back to, remember, they started off in the semifinal having Alonzo Cruz take their set plays. They didn't like that, and they switched to having Pelon take them. They didn't have a whole lot of success with Pelon taking their set play, their knock-ins and stuff. So then they went to Lukitas, and Lukitas, then it started to really, they started to find their groove and rock and roll there. So anyway, we got a penalty five from the spot here going in favor of Brookshire, and here comes the pass down the field. And it looks like it's going to be wide over the back line. So we'll have another knock in here for FMB.
Yeah, that was one area of their game that was struggling in that semifinal. So we'll see here just their second knock in. Now, like you said, they've gone back to their original strategy, plan A, and we'll see if it works out a little better for them here in the final.
Oh, terrible luck right there, but it's picked up. Look at that, Sterling. What a play. Fixes that broken knock-in, turns it positive. Well, not really positive because the other team did get a piece of it, but now it's going to be picked up here by Criado Jr. He continues to move this ball down the field now. Takes a shot, sends it towards the goal. Here comes Peque with a back shot. Picked off right here by Pinello, getting close to that back line. Tomas, able to get to the ball, turns it back around as he's going to be challenged here by, yeah, Sterling goes straight to the man. Next one to get there, Tomas got to it somehow, and he gets away from the man, Sterling. Excuse me. Here goes Tomas Pinello, still with that ball. Alonso comes in, and look at this horse run. Tomas out in front. He's gone. Breakaway status right here. Going to the goal. Oh, wow. They couldn't get a hold of him there. He let that ball get away from him. Now it's picked up again right now by Sterling. Sterling goes back the other direction. Knows he's got Pinello behind him, so he's going to try to run for it right now. Gets past midfield. Peque coming in on a racehorse of his own. Now his teammates right there. Takes it forward. Picked up by Criado Jr. Wants his next shot. Coming in, it's going to be Sterling getting hooked right there. Next one to it, Will Bush. Will's there. Will fires and sends it on through and gets his team on the board. One goal apiece here in chucker number two. Well done, Will.
Great start for Will Bush. Remember, he came on really strong at the end of the semifinal. He scored a dagger goal to really cement the victory. He's had some great moments early in this game. This probably the best. What a finish right there. great awareness to follow up the play.
I agree. Ball's back into play. It's going to be one right here by Peke. Peke's gone on a straight breakaway, going to the goal, back towards the condo, into the field. He's looking good, smooth, calm, and collected as he works his way down the field. He's got Criado Jr. trying to catch him. He can't be caught. Digging to his hope, he misses, but this is Peke Gonzalez. He's not going to miss going to goal on a breakaway like that. He puts it on through, breaks the tie, takes back the lead, and makes a score 2-1.
Peke Gonzalez, unbelievable approach shots this guy always makes. He's on Ibiza here to start this chucker. Right out of the throw, and he sends it down, looks over his shoulder. Look at that. It actually popped up, hit him in the chest. Bit of a bouncing ball, and Toby, more so at the ocean end of the field. We've seen the ball bouncing a little bit. I'd like to see both teams start to shoot from distance, because early in this game, we've already seen some good chances missed because players have, you know, lost control of the ball. Again, these fields are incredible. The maintenance crew out there have done a great job, but remember, it's the end of the season here.
So I'm about to say,
can get beat up, and they'll only get more beat up as this game goes along.
Exactly. Now, Alonzo Cruz takes a man wide, leaves the ball here for Will Bush. Oh, no! Mistimed his shot, but that's all right because he's got Sterling right there. Sterling avoids. He takes a shot at the goal and drills it, sends it on through, and we're back to a tie ball game and a set of deuces on the board. So Will right there really wanted to take his time and hit a net shot, but ended up starting a swing too late and let that one get away from him. But Sterling is able to come in here, clean up the play, and pick up the point.
Right place, right time. Paylon Sterling is following up. Yeah, Will had a bit of a indecisive shot there, and his horse made a weird move on him. Couldn't get contact, but there is Paylon. And just like they did in the semifinals, they just find a way to stick around in these games.
Exactly. Now, Pinello with Sterling, but this is just like we talked about here, you know, before. Sterling trying to put that pressure on Tomas Pinello. Pinello reaching back right here. Sterling comes in to try to steal it away from him. Tomas gets away from him. And now Will is there. The last line of defense is here comes Sterling to take a shot at him. And this ball is wide over the back line. But I tell you what, if FMB wants to win this game, that's exactly what they have to do. They have to keep hammering on Tomas and not let him have a chance to breathe at all.
Yeah, remember that run a few moments ago down the far end of the field? He went end to end riding that Husta, Antu Walung Husta. That horse can absolutely fly, but he's just incredible. It looks like he's going to lose possession. He just somehow always comes out of the play with the ball, and just incredible hand-eye coordination.
Look at the confidence here from Alonzo Cruz, not being rattled at all, having Peke Gonzalez right there on him. And now, oh, what a play. Sterling flips that ball to the right of Peke, takes off running, gets away from him. And now it's going to be, oh, Will came in there a little too hot, tried to take out the defender, ended up creating a danger on this play, and it'll be a penalty 5 from the spot to go in favor of Brookshire.
And maybe just a miscommunication. You can see right here, yeah, just an uneven ride off. He's also sort of pushing Paquito into the right of way as well.
That's exactly what they blew, was pushing the player into the right of way. All right, now here comes the shot over to, look at this, one time at the goal, off to the right. Get there, Scott. Tough break. Nice try, though. So, Paquito, De Narváez, maybe a little nerves here trying to get dialed in, because usually this young man is deadly going to goal. So another lucky break here for FMB. This is going to be their fifth knock-in so far of the game. Alonzo brings the ball into play. Now, miscommunication there. It's going to, Tomas doesn't connect, and here comes Peke Gonzalez to pick up the ball. Hits a quick back shot looking for Tomas. Coming in, Pinello is going to shoot from there and drain it. Look at that, what a shot. Pinello takes advantage of that broken knock-in and picks up the point, breaks a tie, takes back the lead to make the score 3-2 here in chucker number 2.
Well, it might be the team who makes the least mistakes coming away with the trophy here today, and a great job by Brookshire to take advantage of that broken play. And Tomas Pinello gets his first of the day and 30th of the tournament.
And Sterling's going to win the throw-in right here. Takes the hook, takes the ball, keeps it away from Pinello, and now he's breaking back towards that condo end of the field here. Peke trying to chase him down right here. He leaves the ball behind. Now Criado sees it here. Criado comes in, and, well, looks like they might go back and blow this one against Lucas. from the first play there.
I believe the whistle came before the warning horn. Yeah, about 48 seconds. And I do like the whistle. They blew it quickly. You'll see Peke on the line, and Criado comes in, steps over top of the ball. And the umpires don't waste any time. They blow it dead. And we like to see that from the umpires. Hey, I wanted to shout out, there hasn't been a lot of stoppages yet. Remember in that first chucker, Toby, after about 5.5 minutes, we finally had a knock-in. About all eight players, I think, went to change. And we've seen a lot of times players asking in the situation like that for a timeout, horse change, timeout, all may change. The umpires put the ball down, said called play, and everybody had to manage their horses on their own, which I think was a great call by the umpires.
I like that because I think players have gotten to rely too much on that courtesy change. Oh, here comes a pass over to Pinello. He gets hit right there. And it's going to be Paquito here with the next shot. Does it connect? Next one there, Tomas. Now Peke takes a shot. Is that Pojarula that he's on right now? It's going to be picked up here by Alonso Cruz. Takes off running. Now, Alonso keeps it moving right here. He goes ahead, he fires that ball forward, knows he's just about out of time. But yeah, like you were, good that you pointed that out. Exactly right. I think the players have gotten to relying on that courtesy change aspect, and I like the fact that the umpires are not, horse management is a huge part of the game, and so I like to see that the umpires are making these players manage their horses. Score stands 3-2 right now with Brookshire in the lead over FMB here in the finals of the 2023 NetJets Pacific Coast Open. We'll be right back after this quick break here on the USPA Polo Network.
We started really well the first three chuckers, and then the fourth and fifth, I think, Antelope took control of the game, basically. They came up really strong after halftime. We couldn't find the ball. It was really tough to get it away from them, and they were managing really well. So it was quite of a difficult moment for us. We couldn't find our system and couldn't find the ball at all. And they were taking their chances. They scored, I don't know how many goals, I think 7 or I don't know how many, but no, they came up way stronger than what we did after halftime. So they took the momentum out. And well, luckily Matias got injured, and then Matias Marini came in for him. And obviously when you change the team in the middle of the game, it's tough. And I think we got lucky in the sixth chucker that we could find some plays and score, but it was a really, really tough game for us. Well, I think it's shown in the semifinals. I think FFB played amazingly. There's really four guys that work around the field really well. They managed the ball really well, and I think they played really well. The last three chuckers of the semifinals, I think they did amazing. It's obviously going to be a difficult game for us. It's a finals. They have Pelon, which is an amazing player, we all know. Negrito played amazing in the semifinals, and he's been playing really well lately. And then the two boys in the front, they do an amazing job. It's really hard to get away from them. They push forward, they score goals. And I think we have to be close in the marking them, man up with them, and try not to give them space, because once they have space, it's impossible to catch them. So I think be on top of them in every play and try to keep on doing our system. Not that the first three checkers against Antelope we did it, and the last three we couldn't. So hopefully we can make it happen in the finals. Yeah, it's tough. Obviously you have to manage them and see, not play the same horses every time or double them every time, the same ones. Obviously it's tough, you want to win every game, but you have to manage to see which ones you let them rest a little bit more or play more. It depends on how each horse performs, no? Sometimes if you push too much on one, they get flat quicker, but then if you let them rest too long, they get heavy. So it's a little bit depending on how you know them, how you train them, and it's obviously not easy. Now at the end, everybody's tired, but hopefully they do well tomorrow.
All right, welcome back. Here we go, getting ready to play the last chucker, the first half here of the finals of the 2023 edition of the NetJets Pacific Coast Open, only on the USPA Polo Network. I'm Toby Wayman, joined with me as always, Cody Offen, and we have got a 3-2 score on the board. Take a look at these horses here, as you can see, dropping down out of the score bug.
And a good look teams. At Pepsi, and Peke Gonzalez coming out on Pepsi again. I spoke with Peke. And, we know so much about Cinco and Pojarruta, even Sapukai. So I asked him, what's one horse that sort of has, maybe impressed you, made the most improvement from day one to now here this season? And this is the horse he talked a lot about, Pepsi. So keep an eye on Peke here, this chucker.
Fantastic. All right, here comes Pinello. managing the ball right here. Comes in as he's got Criado trying to get to him. Now he goes back to the near side. Works his look at this. He's surrounded by three green jerseys. Finally gets hooked on the play. Sterling comes up with it. Here comes. Whoa! Well done, Peke. Calm as can be. And Zabel to find the goal and put the ball between the posts to double up FMB on the scoreboard. 4-2 now the score. And that is going to be Peke's second goal of the game.
Peke on Pepsi. Right on cue for me as well.
Yeah, right?
The ball will pop out and Peke on the spot here. And yeah, Will does a good job of getting out of the way there, because if he had got that ball hit into him, he'd likely going to be called for the foul there.
Quick little back shot here, and it's going to be picked up now by, well, a whistle from the umpires. They're going to blow this one against Sterling. Let's see what they come up with here. Petaleta is going to be Criado's horse here that he's coming out on. That's one of the siblings here that we talked about. That's a sibling of Ahi.
Yeah, another highlight reel horse, Lac Petaleta. We've seen Luquita score some ridiculous goals on this horse in the gauntlet season and out west here this summer.
And the Wellington Bull Tour.
That as well.
Yeah, and this is going to be so dangerous riding call goes against Sterling. Penalty number 4 awarded to Brookshire, giving them an opportunity to get up by 3 goals here in the last chucker of the first half. Let's see what Tomas does right now.
You know, and Pinello, again, leading the tournament in goals. What's impressive is it's equal penalty goals and goals from the field. So he is just dangerous.
This is in. Watch now. Look at that. He drains it. I could tell as he rode up to that one, he was dead, had the horse's head dead straight. Straight on through, 5-2 now the score, and Brookshire's off to the races.
Yeah, not as high as he wanted, but dead straight, like you said. And perhaps these guys are making an effort not to put too much loft on it because of that win. I might just be speculating,
but
it could be the case.
Man, all right, here comes Sterling, wins the throw-in. Turns the ball back around. Now Sterling sends it back down the middle. Here comes Will Bush, nicely done, takes it straight to the goalies by himself, riding hard to get there. Puckito puts the pressure from behind. Will takes a shot, and no, he missed it. Oh, I tell you what, when you're playing against a team like Brookshire, you cannot afford to leave any goals on the field because they're too strong going forward here. So when you get the opportunity, you got to make it count. All right, Pinello brings the ball back into play and a knock-in here. I believe, if I'm not mistaken, only their second knock-in of the game. Here comes the knock, the shot over to, let's see. Yeah, Paquito launches that ball down. Coming in, it's going to be picked up here by Sterling. As Alonso comes in, he'll take that ball with him. Sterling takes the man for the two-goal player. You got to love that. Then he's going to go ahead and leave this one for Sterling. Sterling gets it back under control. He gets away from Paquito, but here comes, excuse me, that's a Criado. And now, oh, what a read right here by Paquito. He faked that. He saw that Sterling was turning for his back shot, so he did not hit the back shot. He turned the ball, gives it to Tomas Pinello, who fires towards the goal. Can Peke get there? No, nice try, Peke. Over the back line wide, and a lucky break here for FMB.
Definitely a very tough shot from Peke. We've seen him score goals from there, but very difficult shot indeed. So a knock in here for FMB, and like you said, they do need to start getting things rolling a little bit. They can't see this deficit get too big. We saw them play comeback and stick around against Clinton Ranch a bit in that game. But like you said, Toby, this Brookshire team, just so good, so dangerous, you can't dig yourself too big of a hole.
And I tell you, that was an incredible situational awareness there from Paquito. Look, this broken knock in here, but it's going to be Sterling to fix it. He winds up, he sends that ball forward, where he's going to find Alonso Cruz. Alonso Andrade leaves that ball behind. He gets called off by Luquitas, who fires that ball back down the field looking for Alonso, who gets taken out now by Peke. Peke, and well done, Alonso. Keeps the pressure on. Now they leave that ball for Will. Will's going to leave the ball here for Sterling. Sterling sees the man coming to him. He breaks back past him quickly. Now Sterling looks for the pick right here from Bush. He's going to keep going to the right as Tomas wins the throw, or wins the sword fight. Steals that ball away and then pounds it back down. And now it's his teammate's job to go get it and do something with it here. Look at this. Well done. What a play right there by Paquito, taking out the man and letting Peke move uncontested down the field. His shot is off the left. Can they get their Peke shot? He got it. What a goal, Peke. puts it on through, picks up the point and makes the score 6-2 here, and triples up FMB on the scoreboard.
Great job by Peckett going to goal. You can see that ball's nice and settled. He doesn't waste any time. A good half stroke. In case it pops up on him, he'll be able to still get a piece of that ball. Nicely done. 3 goals on the day now for Gonzalez.
And what a play by Paquita to just eliminate the defender and let him move uncontested. Look at this. Here comes Sterling trying to keep this one alive right here. He's in between two orange jerseys. Well done, Peckett. Makes the hook and steals that ball back away. Alonso going zone back, and here comes... Now Paquito using that hand-eye coordination, slaps the ball out of the air with a little tennis serve there. Now he's going to come back to it on his near side as Peckett comes in to help out. He keeps it alive here. He's going to be challenged by Lucas Criado Jr. Now here's the pass back up to Peckett. Peckett is going to call. No, he's going to let Scott have this one. Scott Wood at the goal doesn't connect the way he wants, and Sterling comes up with it right here. Sterling is clean on the play, and he has gone back the other direction with around 2 minutes left to go here. He's going to send this one forward and try to run past the man as he's got Will up in front. Now, Will Bush, nice pickup here. Tomas Pinello is going to come in here and put pressure on as Sterling keeps the pressure going now. Well done, Will makes the bump, but it's picked up by Pinello. Now Sterling back on it. Sterling's challenged here by Peke. Peke just gets out of the way. Sterling slaps this neck shot at the goal. He fired with authority. And, oh, what a save. Man, that was an awesome shot. Picked up right here by Criado. Luquitas, you're going to get the whistle right here. And I'm thinking penalty one on this one. Yep, that does appear to be the case. So it'll be an automatic goal given to Luquitas Criado Jr. And then a penalty 5 from center field to go in favor of Farmers and Merchants.
Yeah, that showcases Luquitas, how crafty, quick he is. He catches Scott Wood just in the wrong place at the wrong time, gets that ball going back to goal so quickly, drawing the foul, gets the penalty one. So a good opportunity here for FMB to get themselves right back in the game. And take a look at that save off of the goal line by Pinello. But then here comes Luquitas, gets it turned so quickly, and Scott Wood has no time to clear out of the way.
All right, 1:37 left to go here in the last chucker of the first half. 3-goal ball game right now. It is still anybody's game. They're going to stick with Alonso taking their set plays here. I like the idea of having Alonso take these. You know, you've got your two higher-rated players receiving the ball, pushing forward, applying pressure. Let's see what Alonso can do here. If he's going to go for it one time, I think he is, yep. Alonso Cruz hammers that ball right down the middle to try to make this a 2-goal swing, picked off here by Pinello. Next one, there's Peke with a tail shot, and Will Bush is going to get to this ball, wanting the whistle there. Doesn't find it, though. Now it's picked up here by Sterling, or by Criado. Criado gets out of there. Sterling takes the man behind. Now Luquitas takes the ball behind his... Oh, no. What a tough luck break right there. The ball comes off the horse's hoof and bounces over the back line wide, so we'll have a knock in here for Brookshire.
I like the thinking there from Criado shooting from distance again.
Me too.
I think both teams need to start taking their chances. Anytime you're within 100 yards here and that ball sitting pretty for you, just take an opportunity.
Every one of them can do it. Yeah, exactly.
Exactly. All 8 players can score from that distance. And, majority of these guys are just dialed in shooting from distance.
And here comes Sterling. Maybe he's going to take our advice right now. One of those defenders to get out of his way. They tell him to use it, stand in the right of way. Let's see what the umpires try to do here. Yep, they're going to go with I like this call here. It's going to be a penalty number 2 going in favor of FMB because Tomas Pinello made absolutely no attempt to get out of the right of way for Sterling when he hit that ball.
And you can see the umpire as he came into your picture. He was in the perfect spot for this. Obviously, it's a little tough. You can see right here, Pinello kind of going back into the right of way.
And never even moved. He just stood there, yep.
Never moved. And it's one of those things, right? If he wasn't standing in the right of way, it would be a penalty against Pinello and Sterling. But like I said, the umpire was literally right behind them on the line.
I think it's a very good call. All right, here comes Criado Jr., 30-yard undefended shot on goal. He winds up and drills it, brings his team back within 2. And that will end the first half of this final of the 2023 edition of the Net Jets Pacific Coast Open. The score stands 6-4 right now, with Brookshire in the lead. Remember, this is a feature game of the week out there at the Santa Barbara Polo and Racquet Club, so we'll take a bit longer than normal halftime because they're going to have the crowd go out there on the field. But in the meantime, Cody and I will see you on the other side of this halftime break here on the USPA Polo Network.
I've been working with Dan for nearly 30 years now, so I grew into polo. So ever since I was little, my dad put me on a horse, and Dan has always been there to help me with horses anytime I needed some. So he's really, without him, I wouldn't be here. No, just I've always been pretty quiet on the field, and they've pushed me to talk more, to interact more in plays, and especially on the man, I tend to look for the ball a lot more than I should. And when you have a 9-goaler and 7-goaler, you got to work more for them. Indeed it is. It's quite the change going from 16 to 20. Luckily, it's still same team, sort of. So I've been playing with Lucas for a couple of times, so it was easy to fill in and get used to this, the new team. We just each did our part that we had to in yesterday's game. And, you know, we had a few lucky breaks. Not the best start we expected as well, but in the end, it all turned out to be. A couple changes with me and Will. I had to be much, much more aggressive going up front, a bit more quicker. I was looking at the ball a bit too much, just more into the game.
As far as Barnes go, it's 10 points.
The weather, the scenic views are unbelievable. To be up here in the mountains in this weather, I don't think you have many choices nicer than this.
I feel like we have some really competitive polo up here. It's friendly competitive polo.
The place is amazing. Good polo fields, good players, good courses, so it's a good experience. It's really good.
Club. They have empanadas there, they have Argentine style barbecue.
I'm in love with this place. The club is really nice, the people is really good.
At least what I can see is that it's an amazing place to be playing polo with the family and with good friends enjoying, and the weather is great. I can't complain at all.
There's so much to do up here, and people are great, and there's some of the best polo in the country up there.
I think this is the place to play for in the summer.
Good as it gets for summer polo.
This may be my new home.
And as soon as our child is old enough, she's going to be in their polo school.
Want to be a horse in that barn.
There's something about when you get up early, prep the plane, and you take off, and you get that first light of day, and the air is crystal smooth. You can see forever. You have to have the right aircraft for the right flight with the right crew up front. Only NetJets can do this. The flight dissolves into the background. It should just be the here and now.
All right, welcome back everyone to the USPA Polo Network. We've got our first half stats. Let's check these out real quick while halftime's going on here.
Well, it's been a tight game so far. Neither team really able to open things up, Toby. You know, both teams very good defensively. Maybe a little nerves. Obviously, this is the pinnacle, the pressure. But you can see both teams having a little difficulty shooting from goal again. The field's a little chewed up in the goal mouth. I'd like to see both teams shooting from distance. As for penalties, really not a lot of whistles. It's been a wide-open game, a good pace to this game. And I think we're going to see the second half really open up here. Both teams having a chance to sit down, grab a drink, talk some strategy, and we'll see who can get the jump out of the halftime break.
Exactly right. Well, when you take a look there, some really good percentages there. All right. Well, let's go ahead and check out some first half highlights, and then we'll come back for the second half of this, the finals of the 2023 NetJets Pacific Coast Open, only on the USPA Polo Network. All right, welcome back, everyone, to the USPA Polo Network. Getting ready to start the second half of this, the finals of the 2023 NetJet Pacific Coast Open. Right now, the score stands 6-4 with Brookshire in the lead. But remember, you know, I always like to say I'd rather go into halftime down by a couple than up by a couple, because you have a tendency to come out hungry. So let's see if FMB can keep from making a liar of me here today, and see if they can start their second half comeback right here now on the fourth chucker.
As we've seen from their last few games here, this FMB team, they're not uncomfortable being behind by a couple of goals. They find a way to stick around in these games. And like you said, this is one of the times where I agree with you, just because of the team, this FMB team, and what they've been able to do. You have the experience of a Pallone Sterling out there. I mean, he might just have these guys right where he wants them, Toby, but we'll see here. This Brookshire team is so good, so strong, and I really think they're going to come out even stronger than they did in the first half. So FMB is going to have an uphill battle ahead of them.
Yeah, they're going to come out swinging for sure, especially, you know, like you said, I would be very, very surprised if they didn't come out here fired up, you know, knowing that they cannot come into this one, you know, lackadaisical. I shouldn't say lackadaisical, but like they did, you know, when they had that 5-goal lead going into halftime in the semifinals, they kind of came out not quite pushing as hard as they did, and they, you know, and they let that Antelope team kind of come back in. So now, you know, I would imagine they learned a lesson there, and they're going to come out here and try to swing as hard as they can and just set the tone for the rest of the game right now. So,
and taking a look on the field here, your semifinal MVP for FMB, Alonso Andrade Gomez, is on your favorite horse, Brad Pitt.
Brad Pitt, there he is. I love it.
Favorite name, I should say. Maybe not your favorite. Maybe not
name. Yeah, but the name is great. Yep.
Another one for Pekka Gonzalez here is Kinze, 15. Am I saying that right? I really hope so.
I think so.
Another horse, he told me, this is one that's made a lot of progress, and he's really happy with the way this horse is going.
What a move that was there from Sterling. Now Cruz picks up that ball, takes it forward. First one back to it. It's going to be Sterling right here. He's going to take a pick from Luquitas. Now he turns the ball back around. He reaches back behind, tries to keep it going right here. He gets hooked on the play. And looks like they're going to catch Paquito on a fouling the second man. Man, that was an incredible move Sterling made on the boards there to just bust through everybody.
Palin Sterling, this is Monica. He's on here.
He's a good horse.
Ducker. As we take a look at the foul one more time. So we'll see FMB back on the penalty line here. Goal shot penalty. Looks like a
two.
Looks like a two or a three. Yeah, penalty number two here.
So, you know, as I looked at the comments here in Facebook, and where people are tuned in from all over the place. Oregon, from Nigeria, from California, Texas. Very cool. Love to hear where everybody's tuned in from. Thanks so much for reaching out to us there. And here we go. Lucas Criado Jr., Luquitas, is going to go ahead and take this penalty number two. The chance to bring his team back within one. And there it is, right down the middle. No hesitation. That kid is a stone-cold killer from the penalty line. He puts it on through, and we've got a ball game here.
Great shot right there. What a start to the second half for FMB. And Toby, just to go back to what you were saying, you know, we have the best fans in the world of any sport, and it's always incredible to me to see where everybody is tuning in from and the commitment they have, no matter what time of day it is, where they are, what they're doing. They take some time to watch the greatest sport in the world.
Pinello wins the throw-in. Tommy Pinello breaks back to the right now. Pinello looking good, coming back across now. Pinello winds up, doesn't like what he saw there. He's going to leave that ball for Paquito. What a play this is from Pinello to Paquito. Oh, no. And the horse kicks the ball right back over to Pinello. Pinello from the outside, just like you were asking for earlier, trying to shoot right here. Didn't like what he saw. Will takes a piece of it there. Back shot. Will Bush keeps the pressure on. Now Paquito back on the ball, looking for a way to get away from those defenders. Here comes Paquito to turn it back around. Will is there. Paquito's going to go ahead and shoot from there and drain it. Look at this. He got it. What a goal. Paquito shoots from distance through the traffic, picks up the point, and gives his team that 2-goal lead back on the board. 7-5 now the score. Cahugador, what a goal right there for Paquito.
Leaner Vice getting it done, and perhaps they talked about this in the tent. We saw Pinelo try to shoot from distance. Paquito gets a chance, and he just fires. Deadly accurate. Man, this kid is good.
Oh, man. He's something else. All right, watch Sterling here. He wins the throw-in. Sterling takes off running back towards that ocean end of the field. Now cruising through those first couple orange jerseys. Now it looks like it's going to be left right here for Will. And Alonzo will shoot. Alonzo shoots at the goal and sends it through. Well done, Alonzo. Andrade Cruz picks up the point, puts the point on the board. We're back to a one-goal ball game.
Getting all four FMB players on the score sheet after that goal. And man, what a game. Back and forth we go.
Both teams liking the ocean end of the field right now.
Yeah, which is interesting because it seemed like the rougher end of the field in the first half. But I was asking for both teams starting to shoot from distance.
And Pinelo wins his throw-in again. Pinelo out of the air. Look at that. He hit that ball on the way down from the bounce. Usually when you hit the ball out of the air, you catch the ball right as it stops at the very top of the bounce. He cut that ball on the way down, like dead center in the mallet head. That is some incredible hand-eye coordination right there from him. All right, Cruz brings the ball back into play for his team. Alonzo.
Oh, no.
No, what happened? Oh, no. I glanced down at my score sheet. His horse locked up on him.
Yeah, just an unfortunate move there. Alonzo cheated a bit.
Hurts.
Peke takes advantage of that. You can see it again right here. Horse.
What happened? Oh, my goodness.
On him. Can't get back to it, and it was already.
Horse's trailer sour right there.
Yeah, exactly.
All right, watch Will Bush. He's going to win this throw-in right here with a back shot. Trying to make up for that last play there. Now it's going to be Pinelo here to pick this ball up, and he's going to be challenged by Cruz. Coming in, Sterling looks for the whistle, doesn't find it, though, and that's going to take him out of the play. And now Tomas Pinelo is going to take off running back towards the other end of the field. Oh, lets that one get away from him, but here comes Paquito, little Paco, to send that ball right back up. Will is there for the defense. Now it's going to be a whistle on the play. Let's see who's right and wrong on this one.
Tomas asking if it's going in their favor. It looks like it may be. Take another look at this one. The ball comes up. Bush having trouble with that bouncing ball. Oh, there it is. The swing over the back of the horse there from Pallone.
Yep. No, from Criado.
Oh, Criado, excuse me. I just saw the black helmet there.
Yep.
And, you know, that's one of those plays. Even if you are getting fouled and you make that chop, you're likely at best going to get offsetting fouls. But an appropriate call there, you could see the position and the reach over the back
lucky.
Of the horse.
Dangerous use of the mallet is a call. I think he's lucky that he didn't get a yellow card on that one, to tell you the truth.
Yeah, I agree with you there.
Pinelo, no trouble, sends it on through and gives his team a 3-goal lead. The biggest lead we've seen here in the second half so far.
But again, it happened really quick. I didn't see it in real time. We got the slow motion replay there. So, you know, the umpires maybe just saw the cross hook, didn't see, you know, because I, you know, that we've definitely seen yellow cards for less than that, but either way, the umpires got the right call. Primarily, we are looking for the safety of the horses and then the athletes on.
All right, Pinelo is going to win another throw-in right here out the back door. Look at that. He's going to take full advantage of having the offensive side. Tommy Pinelo back to the inside. Now, Will Bush comes in to put pressure on him. Here comes Tomas Pinelo. He pounds this one back down. You know, they had a couple series of really unfortunate plays there with that, you know, Alonzo's horse locking up on him. And now, look at this, Paquito gets away from Sterling in the red zone. And a 4-goal lead on the board. And they started off a little slow there for a second. But they're right back into the groove here. And now, really taking full advantage of every mistake made by FMB to give them a 4-goal lead here on the board. That's Paquito's third goal of the game.
Indeed, all three from the field. He's playing extremely well here, getting it done in all three areas. Offensively, in the middle of the field, he's playing a great number three, sending passes up to his other players and getting it done, scoring goals in front.
Well, Emily Marshak said it's turned into a game. It did there for a second, Em, when you wrote that comment, but now it's got away from a little bit here. Here comes the shot back down the field. Larry, it's going to be picked up now by Sterling. Sterling drags that ball back to the left, getting Tomas out of his way. Now he's going to go ahead and take this ball with him, but he lets that one get away from there. Tomas will pick up the play, win this one. First the near side, then Pinelo. Look at that. He keeps Sterling away from him. incredible situational awareness here from Tomas Pinelo. Does not mind giving the ball back over to Paquito. Now Sterling tries to hang with him right here as he's able to run this ball back around. Now Sterling reaches out on the near side. He's going to go ahead and get back to it here, and it's taken now by, oh, Luquita's tough break right there. Ay, ay, ay. Things came from together apart here for F&B all of a sudden here in Chucker number four.
And while we talked about it, Toby, if you make mistakes, this Brookshire team will make you pay, and that's sort of what's happening here. A few too many mistakes, and you can see Peke able to draw the foul there. As always, Peke Gonzalez having a solid game.
7 goals, and you know, Peke, he's just an animal. I mean, you know, there again, you know, you were talking about how Tomas, you know, isn't a big dude. Well, Peke is really not a big dude, but man, he's a giant on the polo field when he's out there playing the game. Uh-oh.
Yeah, well, Peke.
Yellow card Peke's going. Strong. Sorry to interrupt you. It's going to be a yellow card against Criado Jr. here.
Probably.
For a make it, take it penalty two. So it was going to be a penalty two, I believe. If he misses, a re-hit. If he makes it, I think we'll come back to a five. So I don't think they moved this. Wait. No, it was a three, and then they moved it to a two on the yellow card. That is the call. Sorry, Cody. Go ahead.
No problem. He's taking a look at this. I think we were just talking about, yeah, I mean, Tomas Pinelo, you know, you see the picture of him. He's still a very young man. And you wouldn't imagine that. You see him on the field. He is intense as it gets. And,
mm-hmm.
you know, as we've seen all day, he just goes into plays and always comes away with the ball. He's physical, doesn't shy away from that physical game either. And he's so well mounted. He just puts it all together, the complete package. And as you say, Toby, probably the next or one of the next 10-goal players in the U.S.
Absolutely. And look at this. What a play right here. He's not afraid to use that Paquito. And here comes Sterling to take that ball with him. 30 seconds remain right here. Sterling tries to keep it away from Paquito. He's going to stay with the man and leave the ball here for Alonso. Alonso winds up, pounds that ball further down the field here, back the other direction. Can they get one more on the board before the end of this Chucker? They'd really like to, I know that. Here comes a nice play. Sterling horses kick the ball forward, and here comes Paquito near side. Open back shot, perfectly placed right there for Pinelo to pick up. Pinelo looking for yardage right here. Takes his shot back towards the goal. Can he get a buzzer beater off? It is... No, we got more time than I thought. But we just got a whistle right there.
So I think that was the buzzer beater there, Toby, because he hit the ball before the horn. As soon as he touched it at the end there, the referees blew the whistle.
Ah, you're right. Good call, good call. But no, we got a whistle here, so we got – I'm seeing something come through. Well, I tell you what, let's go to break real quick, and we'll come back and talk about it. Right now the score stands 11-6. Brookshire in the lead over FMB here in the finals of the 2023 NetJets Pacific Coast Open, only on the USPA Polo Network.
A hidden gem that most people have never seen. I actually went out and saw a game and fell in love with the horses and the excitement. And frankly, I've never played golf again.
4 goal, 10 goal, 14 goal, doesn't matter. It's probably the most competitive polo that I've ever played in this country.
Really, Houston has something for everyone at every level. You can be at a polo game on Sunday afternoon, see polo for your first time, and on Monday morning, be on a horse with friends in it.
At first watching the games, I was like, this is like a war, a cavalry. Once you learn the rules of the game and you start learning how to ride, it doesn't feel like that at all inside the field. The first time I saw the game that I said, I can do this. There's no feeling like it in the world. I would say try it. Chances are you're gonna get obsessed right as you start.
All right, welcome back, everyone, to the USPA Polo Network. Let's see. Okay, so we had a whistle there at the end. Cody, I think you might have been right as far as, you know, he hit that buzzer beater, and then when he touched it again, that may have ended the Chucker. But I did see something come up here for a penalty, but it looks like they've taken whatever that penalty was back at this point. So we're going to find out here in just a moment when they come back out. But it was an interesting bit of a call right there. So I tell you, things kind of really came apart for FNB. They were doing great until that fourth truck. Basically, when Alonzo's horse sold up on him right there and tried to go back to the trailer, that kind of is where it feels like to me things kind of fell apart. They gave up a goal right there, and then it just got into everybody's heads on FNB team, and they let things get away from them a little bit there. So you know what, Cody? I think you're right about that buzzer beater.
New rules, so there could have just been a little confusion.
Yep. All right, so here we go. Here comes, watch Lucas on this one. Look at this on Criado. He wins this throw-in right here. Gets out of there with it. Criado, near side, neck shot, just enough to get that ball. Turn Peque, open back shot. Over the back line wide.
Peque back on Cinco here to start. Chucker numero Cinco. Our horse is coming back. We've got Palone Sterling back on Oriental Sunderland. He played in the second chucker, one of my favorites of Sterling's. We'll see if he can get his team back in this game.
Is this Petita that Criado is on here?
Yeah, Luquita's back on Lac Petita from early in the game as well.
Now it's going to be left right there for Tomas Pinello. He hits that ball away one time back towards the goal, picked up now by Criado. Luquita's looks up, fires that ball away. Sends it down there looking for Sterling. And the whistle stops the clock. They're blowing this one against Brookshire, probably for falling over the right-of-way after the shot or for blocking one or the other. Looks like they're going to go with a penalty number four here, and they're going to blow this one right-of-way against Paquito.
Take another look at the replay. Yeah, Paquito sort of slid in front of the player there before Pinello hit the back shot. Good call by the officials.
Moving it down to a goal shot penalty, so they go past midfield. So FNB, hey, look, there's still plenty of time left to go here in the chucker.
Again, a lot of horses coming back. Sorry, Toby. Pinello didn't have a horse listed here, but it looks like that's Coronada back from the first chucker, Delfina Coronada, for Tomas Pinello.
So I was talking to Pete Merlos a few weeks ago. And I tell you what, every time I see the guy, he must dread seeing me come around, because every time I see Pete, I corner him for at least 45 minutes because I learn something every time I talk to the guy. And he says he understands the game, and he's such a great communicator, even in a second language. But, we had some conversations about polo and kind of the things that he talked about, you think about it logically. Oh, look at that. Well done. That's a point on the board right there. I don't know what Criado is looking at the umpires for on that one, but he's able to send it on through. And what he's upset about, he made the goal. Don't give it away now.
Here we go. It's up. It's in.
Huh.
He might have just been saying that was in. I'm not sure either if he was talking to the umpires there. Either way, gets his team one goal closer here, Toby.
Unsportsmanlike conduct going against Scott Wood here on penalty five from center instead of a throw in. There's your yellow. Ouch. So, well, anyway, going back to what I was talking about there, Cody, with Pete Merlos, he was saying like when he was coaching, he was saying, I said to him, I feel like coaching is kind of, the last missing piece here to polo that we don't have. Let's see. Scott yelled as FNB went to hit a penalty. That's what the unsportsmanlike conduct was for. Wow, interesting.
It makes sense.
That's a new one.
And it makes sense as to why Lucas was talking to the officials after he scored the goal.
Yeah, exactly. Look at this. Criado right down the middle. Is he going to drill it? Oh, man, it's there. And it's going to be Bush. Oh, no, he didn't make a play on the ball. Now, Alonzo goes in to take a shot at Tomas Pinello. Pinello hits a shot up here for Paquito, who keeps it running forward. Now, Paquito keeps this one here, having a tough time. He can't take a full swing because he's got Sterling behind him. Sterling wins the play, steals that ball back away. Tomas Peque is trying to get to him, and now here's Alonzo trying to lay a pick for him. Sterling trying to get that ball back under control. He does so now. Ooh, what a bump there from Peque. Sends it forward, but here comes Luquitas Criado to win the play. Criado, next shot, back down the field here. Looking for Cruz. Next one to get to, it's going to be Paquito. Super well mounted, this young man right here. Look at this. Turns back the inside of Will Bush. And now he goes to run past him, but Will stays right there with him. He's not taking the bait at all. Uh-oh. They're going to catch him right here. They're going to blow this one against Paquito for hitting into the horse.
Yeah, that was my first instinct. We'll probably be able to see it better from a different angle, but you can see Paco looking to the sky, likely a spot hit here, because it didn't look like Will really had to move too much out of the way. You can see Paco has his horse's head facing down the field, but the line's still going 45 degrees the other way there. So I think that's a great call by the officials.
Penalty 5 here goes in favor of FMB, down by 4, with still 5:03 left to go here in checker number 5. So anyway, yeah, so he was, so something that you know, Pete there was saying was, he's like, you know, yeah, when you talk about coaching, he said, you know, in every other sport, when a team gets put together, the first thing they do is they hire the coach, and the coach hires the players to you know, play under his philosophy. Whereas in polo, the coach is brought on board, you know, when things start to go wrong. And so oh, wow, what a goal right there by Sterling. He drills it straight on. No, excuse me. I'm sorry. Luquito's got that one. Put it straight on through. And now we've got a real ball game here. A 3-goal difference on the board. 11-8 the score.
Well, all 5 of Criado Jr.'s goals so far, penalties. This one just happens to be a penalty 5. Don't see it too often. Just drilled that.
Man, what a shot.
Drops it right in there. And again, FMB just sticking around. They have a chance here.
They sure do. 3-goal difference on the board. Plenty of time left to go. Now, here comes the shot, and it's going to be picked up right here by Peke. And he gets caught right there. And hits that ball after the whistle, too. I don't know if they're going to catch him for that, too, or not. But they do blow a penalty 5 from the spot against Peke.
If he wants the extra whistle, maybe a yellow. Certainly don't.
They're going to get it, too. Yep. Yeah.
Unfortunate. You don't think – I really – wouldn't think Peke does this on purpose. He probably didn't hear the whistle. He goes for the next shot, but it was, you know, well after the whistle.
So it goes from a spot to a center on the yellow card.
You know, you see that happen a lot or often when it does happen out of frustration. It just didn't seem like that was the case there for Peke. Again, speculation, but yeah. Either way, the appropriate call made.
And here comes Lucas. So, yeah, they're changing it up again here. They're having Criado take this one. Lucas taps the ball into play. Did they get improper blocking right now? And here comes the next shot over to the left where he's going to find Sterling. Sterling with Tomas playing off him a little bit here. Sterling, he goes ahead. He sends that ball back at the goal. Alonso's going to get there. Alonso with the man. Alonso, and now the back shot picked up right here by Criado. Now by Wood. Now stolen by... Oh, well done. Tomas got that ball out of the danger zone. And then it's going to be Sterling here to apply some pressure. He'll leave the ball for Peke to come through hot. Peke takes it forward here. Now loses the play there too. Criado Jr. Look at these two fighting for the – oh, the ball's over the boards. And we lost a board too. So we have a possession play given up by Brookshire in favor of FMB. And the clock has stopped while they put the board back in. Well done, fans.
Man, what a save. That series of events right there. That ball dangerously close to the goal line. Pelon there was able to somehow steal it, but Pinello almost instantaneously stole it right back.
He sure did. Okay, so Criado brings the ball into play, hits this one down the right-hand side where he finds. Look at that. What a perfect pass here to Sterling. Sterling takes his time. Sterling in the red zone. Sterling shoots at the goal. No, he let it get away from him. Rolls over the back line wide.
Oh boy,
but FMB putting pressure forward now.
What a glorious chance there. You won't see Pelon Sterling miss that too often. Credit to Paquito de Nervais there, putting the pressure on defensively.
Tomas with the ball. Brings the ball back into play. Look at this. Knock-ins 8-4 here for FMB. That's 8 goals left off the field there by Brookshire. Now Alonso goes in there, makes the hook, but here comes Paquito to back him up, and now it's going to be taken right here by, what a play. Paquito avoids the hook there from Sterling. Now Paco, little Paco with the ball on the board, past midfield, winds up and hammers it down, and Tomas is gone on a straight break right here. Nobody's there. It looks like it's going to be over the back line wide, so we'll get another knock in here for F&B, and we've got some players running off to change onto some fresh horses in the meantime.
There's too much power on the pass there. That would have been a fantastic setup if Pinello was able to get a goal shot off on that play. Diener Weiss, again, just showing off the skill there. His polo IQ is incredible. I was trying to think of a way to describe Paquito. Well, wait a second. We may have something happening here, Toby.
What is this? Let's see. Unknown foul by Scott Wood. Okay, so they blow a penalty 5 from the spot right there. So, yeah, he must have had something happen there. Now here comes the pass as Sterling waits for the umpire to get out of his way. Now Sterling has control of that ball for a give and go right back up to Criado Jr. He sends this one back down looking for Luquitas, and it's going to be Peque to win the ride-off. Criado comes in looking to make a play there on that ball, picked up here by Tomas Pinello. Pinello fakes the ball. Oh, what? Look at this. Cruz steals it away. Alonso in the red zone. Alonso! No! I cannot believe it. Oh, my goodness. Steals the ball from Pinello. And then he must have thought it was going to go in. Maybe it took a bad bounce or something because he didn't look like he was trying too hard to get there.
Yeah, that final shot always the toughest. A little in between the approach and the goal shot just got away from him. Oh, man, I feel his pain, but Toby, you cannot miss those chances. A couple glorious chances for FMB recently here, and one missed by Sterling and that one by Alonso Cruz.
Yeah, that would have put him back within one right here instead of down by 3. Now, here comes Sterling and Criado. Ooh, Sterling is going to jump on that ball. Sterling turns it back to the inside of the defender. Takes a hit from his own man, then takes off down the right-hand side as Peque comes in to put him in the pocket. He's going to go ahead and make the run right here, continues the drive, takes the ball off the boards, leaves it now for Criado Jr. Criado sends it forward. Now he's stopped right there with Tomas, trying to find a way to get away from Tomas Pinello, trying to get him to look over the wrong shoulder. He's going to go ahead and fire to the middle right here where he's going to find... Sterling wanted a whistle there, did not find it, though, and it's Paquito with the ball. Little Paco hits a neck shot back down. Will takes the man wide, and the ball's off the playing field, and we're down to the final few seconds here. Let's see. We've got a possession play right now, and will they get enough time? Yep, he beats the horn. Look at this little chip shot back over there for Sterling. Sterling comes in with Pinello on him. Sterling now takes that ball. Keeps it under control right here. He's got Pinello on his hip, so he knows he can turn the ball. Now he's going to go ahead, takes the hit from Peque. He shoots at the goal. Oh, no, my goodness. 3 missed goals right there. In this chucker. That's a tie ball game right there. Had they just scored those 3. Let's watch this one more time.
Well, just brutal luck here. It's deflected, so... Will there be
safety
when we come back? Yeah, probably. We'll get the official word. But like you said, 3 chances in the last couple minutes of the chucker could have had this game tied up, Toby.
Score stands 11-8. Brookshire in the lead. We'll be right back for the final chucker of regulation time here on the USPA Polo Network. All right, welcome back, everyone, to the USPA Polo Network. We've got upcoming nights championship to take a look at here, Cody?
Yeah, September 15th and 17th, right here on the USPA Polo Network, we have the Knights Championship from the Newbridge Polo and Country Club. So we'll have the Open Division and the Girls Division as well competing in this year's Knights Championships National Youth Tournament Series Championship, coming to you live on the USPA Polo Network from the Newbridge Polo and Country Club.
All right, so I just got two pieces of information here. So we got confirmed it is going to be a penalty number 6 to start this chucker off. And the reason that we had that penalty 5 from the spot down on the ocean end of the field there, where we thought it just Paquito hit the ball over the back line, they brought it back like 20 yards. What happened there was Scott Wood reached over the back of Will's horse to try to hook him as he ran past, and that's what that spot hit was for down on that end. So just a little clarification there.
Here's another look at that last play. You can see that ball's going in. So a good save by Paquito gives up the penalty 6, but they'll take it.
Saving the ball. He'll make him do it the hard way here.
You know, to our viewers, if you never had a chance to see Paquito's father play, Paco Inervice Sr., just a world-class player, you know, an exciting player too. His style of play, always super well mounted, as we've continued to see Paquito doing. And, you know, just the style of play by Paquito that we've seen early in his career, I have no doubt he might surpass his dad and be better than Paco Sr. ever was, which I'm sure Paco would be very happy about.
Well, you know, the other thing here too is Paquito and Peque are cousins too. I don't know if you knew that or not. Mariano, yeah. So Mariano's father, Peque's father, Mariano, his sister is Paquito's mother, Rocio. So right now, Paquito there. So, you know, kid comes from some really good, strong polo stock. Here comes, better get going now because Tomas is coming in hot. Now, near side back shot going to be picked up here by Peque. Uh-oh, he's gone and now going to the goal. Doesn't connect. Alonzo Cruz with a back shot right here to set up Luquitas. But wait, we get a whistle. We do have a whistle here, and it looks like it's going to be a right of way going against Luquitas. Penalty number 2 awarded to Brookshire. Ouch.
Peque on Sapukai here for the first time today, saved for the 6th chucker.
Yeah.
Sapukai, maybe.
Rumba for Paquito. I know this horse, Rumba. I feel like Rumba won Best Playing Pony at some point. Was it this past? Was it this year? Or maybe it was last summer. But I remember Rumba winning a Best Playing Pony.
Very well could have been in the 16 goal this past winter.
Maybe it was. Maybe that's what it was. Yeah. Tomas, no trouble, sends it straight on through and gives his team that 4-goal lead back on the board. But plenty of time left to go here. But FNB needs to win this throw-in right now if they want to have a chance to come back, even with 6.5 minutes left to go on the clock.
You know, and just jumping back real quick to Paquito, I was trying to think of a way to describe him. It's almost like he's got a 10-goal brain, and he's just waiting for his young body to fully develop and catch up to his brain. He's so good. His polo
kid's incredible situational awareness. Yeah, I tell you that. Oh, Sterling. Uh-oh. Paquito, and now it's going to be Paquito jaws the whistle right here. Oh, terrible luck for FMB. So they kind of fell apart in the fourth. They took control in the fifth, and now they're kind of letting things fall apart here again in the sixth.
Yeah, and we can't even script that any better. You get a good look at the horse quality and the awareness there by Paquito to draw that foul, turning so quickly.
Penalty 3 on top of that.
You know what? That's an appropriate call. I know it's far down the field, but if you make it a 4, like you often say, Toby, give the fouling team an advantage by letting them put all 4 players back behind the ball.
Okay. Pinello along the ground. Oh, they could have gone it, but they weren't able to do so. And now it's 13-8, the score on the board. So we've got a 5-goal ball game here. It is still, they can still do it, FMB, but right now the momentum is firmly in the on the side of Brookshire here.
Certainly a little icing that goal, but like you said, enough time, but it's going to be extremely difficult, especially against this opponent. For Pinello, that's 6 goals on the day and a nice even 35 on the tournament, leading all players.
All right, here we go. Ball's back into play, and it's going to be picked up here by Cruz. Alonso gets out of there with that ball with Peke in pursuit. Peke makes the hook, doesn't connect on the ball, and here comes Paquita, or excuse me, Luquitas to back him up. Luquitas winds up, gets some loft on that ball, drops it down in front of Sterling. Out of the air, Sterling reverse neck shot right here at the goal. Wide over the back line. Ay, 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 that hurts a lot.
Just having a real tough time scoring goals, especially down
on that end, yeah.
End of the field, the east end there. And FMB, you can see they've missed a number of shots from the field, shooting 40%.
Paquito brings this in, one into play, hits it straight, too far, and it'll be turned back around here by Criado Jr. His shot picked up right there by Sterling. What a read by Sterling. Sterling keeps it away from Peke right here and keeps it going right now as he drops that ball. Peke comes back to it. Quick open back shot there. First one to get turned is going to be Luquitas right here. Tomas Pinello is going to let him get to the ball and turn it back around. Tomas thinking about doing some poaching, but Criado gets that ball turned back. Tries to push it. Now it's going to be Lucas to wind up and loft this ball. Lob it back down there in front of, oh, well done. Another fantastic play here by Paquito. But I tell you what, he is playing lights out here today. Back shot, and now it's Peke to jump on that ball again. Peke Gonzalez back to the inside right here, and he flips it over to Tomas. Fantastic play from this Brookshire team, this young Brookshire team. Right back up there. Look at that. Perfect pass there to Paquito. He hit that ball just enough so that Paquito could get to it, but not enough so the defender could get a shot on the ball. And now it's going to be a quick back shot, now taken forward here by Criado. Luquitas with the ball. He sends it forward, and there's the tail shot, and Luquitas will get back to it again. Criado knows he doesn't have time to let this one roll over the back line. He needs to keep it in play. He sends the ball down the left-hand side. Cruz waits for it to pass him. Alonso pounds it back on down the field, and he's going to find Will Bush out there. But here comes Scott Wood for the defense. Scott takes it forward, and now here comes Will. Avoids the hook from Paquito. Goes near side here. Looking good. Bush leaves it now for Cruz. Makes the hook. Next one there is going to be Pinello with a neck shot across the goal. Tomas being pursued right now by Sterling. Sterling, oh, what a play by Tomas. Just left him dead to rights over there in the corner. Sends it down for Peke. Peke waits for the ball to catch up. Knows he's got one shot here. He gets a look at this horse. What a play by Peke Gonzalez. Now he gets called off the ball by Tomas. Tomas takes it off the boards, but puts the ball over the boards off the playing field. So a possession play given up by Brookshire in favor of FMB. And it's looking more and more like Brookshire is going to sweep all 3 high goal tournaments out there on the West Coast.
Might just be a matter of time here. 5-goal lead, 2.5 minutes left. Brookshire really putting it together, topping off an incredible season.
Oh, what do we got? Wait, procedural violation by FMB?
Just nothing going their way right now, Toby.
Really, yeah. So this, instead of a possession play, they give up a penalty 5 from the spot. So I'm not sure what the procedural violation is. Hopefully I'll get word on that momentarily.
Yeah, you might think either hitting the ball before play or waiting too long to hit, you know, on those possession plays.
That could be. That's true. You got 8 seconds to hit. Pinello, well, let's see. Here's Pinello, picks up the play. Watch this. Tomas. Oh, yeah, he's got it. He's not going to miss right here. Tomas works it on through, gets that unlucky 13 off the board, and gives his team a big 6-goal lead here with just a couple minutes left to go, and it's looking more and more like this is Brookshire's summer season here in California. What a play by Tomas Pinello.
Yeah, not afraid to say that's the final nail in the coffin. No way back now for FMB. This Brookshire team certainly won't let it happen. They're too good, too well-disciplined. They're not going to start fouling here in the last 2 minutes. Just too difficult anyways to come back.
So, yeah, even if they did, you're right. With only 2 minutes left, 6-goal difference, yeah. But nevertheless, let's see what they get done here. I know that FMB is not going to quit until that final horn sounds. Sterling. I got a chance to talk to Sterling earlier today, and he said that, you know, he's leaving tomorrow to go to Argentina, and he's going to be – they've got the Jockey Club starting soon. Oh, look at this, Will Bush. Oh, nice try, Will. What a shot.
Yeah, it would have been nice for Will to score that one, a little consolation. And, hey, listen, this FMB team probably won't like to hear it, but still a lot of people probably didn't see them in this final. So a good tournament and season for this team, despite coming up short here in the finals.
All right. Here we go. It's going to be a run down the left-hand side here from Paquito. Looking to put some more air in this horse's lungs. This is the last game of the high goal season out there. The pinnacle of American summer polo right here. Here comes Paquito. Goes to run past that defender. He puts it right into the horse. Now it's picked up here by Luquitas. Then now Sterling. And now Peque. Going to continue to fight with his friend right here. Gets out of there with that ball. Near side. Open back shot. What a shot from Peque. Man, that was a beautiful back shot. But what do we have here? A whistle stops the clock with like 31 seconds left.
Love the intensity. These guys don't stop. Peque Gonzalez still going for it, fighting for that ball.
If for nothing else, in bragging rights against his buddy, you know?
And not sure if Peque got nabbed for something there trying to make so that. Either way,
they're
like
blowing this one against Paquito for dangerous riding. Okay, yellow so card against Paquito.
There it is
right there. Yeah. Oh, you went down.
So, yeah, just off screen there, we could see the contact, a little mistimed, uneven. So likely still the last play of the game upcoming here. A good catch there by the officials.
Right there, yep.
We just don't get a great look at it, but, yeah, he catches him a little ahead of the saddle, not well-timed, and as Luquitas on the ground.
Penalty 5 from midfield here, and I would imagine Luquitas is going to hit this one time. Let's see if he can end the game right here by draining it from midfield. You know, I would go out on a limb here and say that, you know, this is Jesse Brace, you know, patented play right here. So, but before we go, I was going to say, yeah, you know, I was talking to Pelon, and he was saying, yeah, got the jockey open starting down there, and then, you know, he's geared up, ready for the Argentine Open. And he said that Adolfo had said that this is going to be his last year playing with Peroto in the Open. But I asked him, is this Adolfo's last Open? He says, you know, after, you know, it depends. If we win, your attitude is different than if you lose. So we'll see, you know. So he didn't want to go down on one way or the other on that one. But he said that he heard that Adolfo had said in an interview that this was going to be the last time he plays with Peroto in the Open. So that's something right there. Here comes the final knock-in of the game, and that is going to be it. Final score is going to be 14-8. Brookshire is the winner, and they will sweep all three of the 20 gold tournaments out there in Santa Barbara. What a game this turned out to be.
Fantastic game for Brookshire. They really put it all together. Toby, FMB, they were in it for most of the game, but credit this Brookshire team. They really put their foot down at the end, got it done. Some spectacular players. Scott Wood should be very proud of this team that he put together. Some superstars on this team. Scott Wood, hey, he has his name all over that trophy under a different team name. He'll be very excited to see his Brookshire polo team on that PCO trophy. Toby, what a fantastic game. Love to see how happy these guys are getting this big win.
Boy, what a game. All right. Well, on that note, I'd like to go ahead and say, you know, thanks so much, everyone, for tuning in. Okay. So, yeah, thanks, everyone, for tuning in to the USPA Polo Network. For Cody Offen, I'm Toby Wayman. We will see you for the Knights Tournament Championship coming up here September 15th and 17th is when we'll be back with you here on the USPA Polo Network. And so until then, we will see you, and thanks again for tuning in to the USPA Polo Network.
Of our trophy presentation underway. We're going to bring in the best playing pony as soon as we can clear a path here. Come on, Peggy, bring him on in. Peggy Gonzalez, bring on your horse, please. Welcome to the winner's circle, Peggy. Start things off with our best playing pony presentation so he can go home to the barn here in a minute because this horse has worked hard. Sandy Gonzalez's horse. Zaku Kai, okay, and I believe the third and the sixth sharper. Sandy, these guys. Look at that. That's a nice little horse right there. Pepe, stay up there, man. We got another award for you. Our best string award also goes to Pepe Gonzalez for the best string of the season. I think John Muse and David Sigmund are going to bring that out here. Well, we have the horse in the picture. This is the Molly Quigley Best String Award named in honor of one of our colleagues who passed away this year. Pepe, taking home a lot of hardware here today. Well deserved, though. Don't drop it. All right, congratulations, Peggy. Congratulations, Saki Kai. Congratulations to the crew. You worked hard to get the horses here and your best string award. All right, next up. Let's come on to the team awards. I think we'd like to welcome Farmers Merchants Bank up to the trophy stand. A great deal of resilience this year. They had a few changes of pace along the way. But they arrived at the final of the Pacific Coast Open. Okay. We'd like Aaron Pitzker and Luke Hatfield from NetJets to please come on up and present some trophies. Thank you. All right, NetJets, our corporate sponsor of the NetJets Pacific Coast Open. Aaron Pinsker, Luke Hatfield here in Mary's out to the team. Congratulations, a huge accomplishment to arrive at the final of the TCO. They played a great game, worked very hard to do this, get here today. We got more prizes, guys, keep handing them out. Oh, these look like some nice helmets. Safety first. Congratulations, Farmers and Merchants Team. Great job today. Very proud to have you guys in the final. All right. Thank you, guys. Congratulations. Next up, Berkshire Polo, Scott Wood, Paquito de Narvaez, Becky Gonzalez, and Tomas Canelo. Come on up, guys. Second year in a row on the surface stand, and Peggy Gonzalez. Our winners here today, we've got trophies here from Aaron Pinsker and Luke Hatfield and John Muse. Lots of trophies, so many trophies for our PCO winners here. Our sponsor, NetJets. We'll hand these out. Well, that looks nice. Replica PCO trophies, very historic. Little blankets keep you warm on the plane ride home. You're gonna need an extra hand for all these things, guys. Very nice, very nice. PCO trophies. Congratulations, guys. You played awesome. Take it home. The PCO, the Silver Cup, the America's Cup. Berkshire Polo looking good here today. I think, careful, that trophy's ready to start. Congratulations. I think, do we want... Of you at the trophy. Just close. Touching it. There you go. Looks good. Congratulations, guys. Fantastic. All right. Do we want the rest of the team on up there? All the families? All right. Let's get the whole organization up there. All the Dean Arvai family, Martin Munoz. Wow, it takes a village, it really does. Let me tell you, there's a lot of guys there that were riding singles early in the morning to make that happen here. All right, we got two more awards. We're not done yet. MVP, TCO, I believe. All right. All right, Margarita Landy here to present our game MVP. Margarita, go and step up front, and Tomas Pinello, come on back. Our MVP of the final, Tomas Pinello. This guy was magic with the ball today. One of the highest scorers in the game. Margarita Landy, there to do the honors. Little presentation. So get back to carry home all those trophies you just collected. Congratulations, Tomas. All right, one more award. This one is a very important award, very special and historic award. The Skeen Season MVP. I'll hand it over to Curtis Skeen, son of the late, great Bob Skeen, to take this one away.
So this is the last award for this season. Robert Skeen MVP. It's the most valuable player for the entire high goal season. It's the Robert Skeen Trophy, the America Cup, the Southern Cup. It is given to the player. Closer? Got that? Okay. So this award is given to the player, the most valuable player for the entire high goal season, which excels beyond their handicap in supporting their team, while at the same time upholding the highest values of integrity, the traditions of sportsmanship in the sport of polo. And this year, the award goes to Pekka Gonzalez. Yeah, baby!